Welcome back. It's the Breakfast on PLUS TV Africa. The economy is our focus this time around, and not so cheery news right now because Nigeria's import bill has actually grown as our export is still, you know, oil dependent. What do we need to do? What should we be focusing on right now? Because we're having an 8.9 trillion naira deficit in 9 months. Joining us right now to do justice to this particular discussion and to make some sense of all of that is Mukhtar Mohammed. He is a financial analyst and economic consultant. Many thanks for joining us on the Breakfast and PLUS TV Africa, Mukhtar.
My pleasure this morning. Good morning.
Yeah, good morning to you too. Indeed, Nigeria's import bill has actually grown in the past 9 months, and we're still, you know, focusing on, oil-dependent export. Over time, we have talked about economic diversification, but were you alarmed when you got wind of that particular information that we are actually spending so much on importation?
The only way you would have been alarmed is if you are not in Nigeria. If you are not in Nigeria, you know definitely about 80 to 90% of what we even consume, we export it, we import it. So you shouldn't be so surprised by what with the report that we got from the National Bureau of Statistics. We've always known this. We've said Nigeria is trying to diversify, but I've always said if you don't diversify holistically, you diversify with competitive advantage, and we're not doing that. The only means of our revenue still remain oil, and like you said during the introduction, it's an oil-dependent economy. It has not changed, and it won't change anytime soon. So I'm not surprised. I'm not surprised at all. And if you look at that report, it will also bring you to your notice that what we do is that we export crude oil, and we import the refined product back to Nigeria. So it also that when you look at that report, you look at that bill, you realize that if we start refining our petroleum product here in this nation, then we've solved almost 80% of our economic challenges that has to do with forex volatility, and then we'll have a lot of money to do other infrastructural development. So it's not a surprise, but it's just that are we ready to do the work?
Mm. All right, it's a good thing that you have mentioned the work. And the question now would be, what responsibility, what role do we have, government at different strata, to ensure that, you know, the story changes? So we rather have the fact that we have a growing export and a reduction in import.
Well, those things are not things that are achieved overnight, and they have to come with careful planning. And you can look at it, the government is trying to do that first and foremost. They are not the one doing it, and I'm in support of that government is not in the business of government to be in business. So they are partnering with Dangote Refinery to make sure that in the coming years, I'm not looking at 2022 or 2023, it's going to be in the coming years, we could see that we begin to refine our petroleum product here in Nigeria. That is one. Then, secondly, you can see that even when we are complaining about CBN intervening in non-conventional in a conventional banking area, like trying to make sure that we have self-sufficient, especially in the area of food production, we can see that in the area of rice. But if you look at that bill now, we didn't see rice then, but we saw wheat. And CBN has gone after beginning to encourage wheat farmers by giving them some facilities also to grow. So we are doing it, but it's not something that can happen overnight. And again, inconsistency in terms of policy could be another big challenge, because sometimes there's always this policy somersault from our own government.
All right, Mukhtar, let's try and break down some of the highlights of this particular, you know, development. From what we know, the value of imported agricultural goods was 21.01 higher than the value recorded in the second quarter of 2021 and 56.74% higher than the third quarter of 2020. So the question right now, let's stay on that for a bit. The question right now is that why are we still importing agricultural goods when we could actually, you know, harness that? We have arable land, we have all that it takes to be a Greek giant, you know, in the region, Africa, and of course the world.
You agree with me when it comes to being a Greek giant, you have, like I said, you have to be competitive advantage. When you talk of cocoa, you talk of Ghana. when you talk of you talk about certain product, when you say you need to mention that, oh, they are the agenda. When you talk of rice, you talk of Thailand, you talk of Malaysia, you talk of Indonesia. They had to carefully develop those areas. So Nigeria need to come to the area whereby we know what we want. First and foremost, we need to begin to see how we can provide food for ourselves here in Nigeria first. And that data is telling you that we've not been able to provide food for ourselves. Remember, we've not banned the importation of any goods into Nigeria. Rather, we've just hiking the tariff. And Nigerians crave for foreign apartheid goods is still there. So it will continue to be a problem. And then secondly, again, you need to look at the insecurity in the land also have not helped matters. So some of the products that we normally would have gotten in Nigeria, farmers are beginning to, they are afraid of going to their farms. So we are beginning to restore back to importation. Even the government just complained of recent that there are more influx of imported rice through the border. You can see that, and this was an area that we thought we're already beginning to have sufficiency in terms of about 60-70%. So insecurity is one problem. Then you talk about infrastructure, also it's a major challenge. Infrastructure, we're talking about moving of your goods, cost of production, moving of your goods from one point to another. So all these are major challenges, and these are not challenges that can be addressed in one off. And we have, like I said, we always have some policy somersault. We seem to say this is the way we want to go. Another administration will come and change the narrative. So until we come up with a blueprint on how we want to go in terms of sufficiency in food production, we'll not achieve it. In 1978, the World Food Organization was established because of the world was afraid that China, with the type of population growth, they will not be able to feed themselves. So the world came together so that when they come that challenge, all of us can contribute to begin to feed China. When China saw that, they saw it as an opportunity and they begin to look inwardly. And today, China is exporting more goods in terms of food production to other parts of the world from the people that were trying to save them. So it has to come with planning and knowing that, look, we have a challenge here. We are not going to play politics with it. We need to know who and who is going to help us. We don't need to come and begin to defend it. We don't need to come and say we are doing what we are not doing. We need to cry out that we need help in terms of development, in terms of infrastructure. And that could just be it.
Okay, so we all know that, you know, the country is administered in local governments. You also have wards, councils, villages. You have the state government at work. I want you to take us through if... because constantly when we talk about, you know, development and diversifying the economy, the focus is usually on the government, I mean the central government. So I'd like to understand, at the local government level, at the state level, is there a role that can be played? Are there policies that can be formulated that would encourage, you know, export? Because at the end of the day, or our less dependent on oil?
Well, unfortunately, there's little the local government can do because what we have the exclusive rights in terms of resources. In the legislature, they say the exclusive rights, those are what you don't even talk about. There's no state on its own can begin to export a particular product that is produced in that state. It has to go to the federal government. The federal government is the sole people that can export such goods, not even the state. So it has to go back to the constitution. You have to go back to what they have been trying to restructure it. So it's not something that can be done by any state. What a state should begin to think of is whether you'll be able to feed yourself inwardly. That's what they should be looking at, thinking of developing. You can see Lagos State was partnering with KB State in the area of rice production. Then, but when the insecurity comes in, how much partnership can you do with the level of insecurity in terms of movement of these goods and services? That is a major challenge that we are facing. There are some products that we don't need to struggle to begin to produce. We can produce rice, we can produce garri, cassava is there, we can produce yam. But when you see the food basket of the nation, which happened to be Benue State, that being engulfed in a lot of insecurity between the farmers and the herdsmen, and at the end of the day, they were not going. You look at the northeast have to be the food where you get all the perishable goods from the tomatoes, the pepper, but you can't even move them from there because of insecurity. So definitely adding to our problem is the insecurity. And these are not insecurity challenges that have been able to be summoned by this government. But now you can say the government is doing what they have to do to make sure they address that. Once we address insecurity, then we'll begin to talk about self-sufficiency in terms of food production, maybe 60% for the time being. But for now, it's a big challenge.
All right, Mukhtar, interestingly, solid minerals exports value in the third quarter of this year, you know, increased by 22.7% compared to the second quarter of 2021 and 222.8% compared to the third quarter of last year. We seem to have, you know, made a good, you know, in that particular, you know, sector of the economy. Why are we not exploring more when it comes to solid minerals?
It has to do with infrastructure. If you look at those solid minerals, do we produce anything gold here in Nigeria? Do we have an industry that is in production of gold? Do we produce our weapon, locally made weapon here? So what you see is that when you talk about solid mineral, we are exporting the refined product, I mean the unrefined products out of the country. So we can begin to see if we could be able to develop industries here in Nigeria for this product, that could be an added advantage. So what you're seeing there, you are happy about it, is just in the area of what we are doing in the petroleum sector, the same thing we are doing in that sector, just exporting the raw materials and whereby the finished products are still imported into our country. So it's like what you say, Europe, Peter to paper.
All right, Mukhtar, you know, I saw you smiling there. But then again, let's talk more, you know, that our foreign trade deficit, you know, it's actually, this is the eighth consecutive quarter that we've had this particular negative trend. And so far, a negative trade balance of 3.02 trillion naira compared to 1.87 trillion naira deficit we recorded in the previous quarter. You know, we are approaching the end of the year. Now, what can we begin to do differently to ensure that our balance of trade and balance of payment are sort of equitable somehow?
It's not, like I said, it's not a short-term problem. You can't give a short-term solution to a problem that has been here like forever. The pandemic also did not help matters, and government have to begin to concentrate on how to deal with the pandemic instead of thinking of how they can empower the non-oil sector. So I think that is the major challenge as a nation. So it's not something that can be addressed in the short term. It's something that we could think of palliative, and that has to be with government trying to address this, and that also will affect government revenue. So it's something that we have to do gradually. Like I said, the first area we have to address this issue is to make sure we deal with the insecurity challenge, especially in areas that we know their contribution economically to the nation is very, very important. When we handle that, then we begin to see how we can begin to empower farmers like the CBN trying to come up with wheat. We can have some of our products that are being imported, then we can begin to have, especially household products, for children, especially the children. And then when you look, even if you look at federal government policy of feeding of school children, you realize that most of the products also are even being imported. So it's a big challenge. So what we need to do is to begin to address the security challenges first, then try to see how we can begin to help farmers grow in terms of giving them loans. And then secondly, we need to look at the Land Use Act. It has been like one of those ancient acts that have not been repealed or new ones up. Let's begin to see how farmers can use their land to begin to get loan to grow the agricultural product. That could be one of the game changer, and I think government is not looking at it yet.
All right. Finally, before we let you go, Mukhtar, you know, indeed, we need to improve the security situation in the country. But then again, don't you think we need to improve on our bilateral relationship with other countries abroad and our export and policy generally? Because we had a guest just before you came on, you know, on this particular discourse. He talked about how they have lots of bottlenecks when it comes to exporting some, you know, agricultural produces such as cashew nut and all of that. And China, you know, indeed put Nigeria on their red list. So how do we begin to manage all of this so that we can have an effective, you know, export policy in Nigeria?
I always say the first thing we have to do is to see how we can trade within ourselves in Africa. That's why I'm so happy in the African Continental Trade Agreement. Once they begin the volume of trade between Africans and Africa, they will not be depending so much on the Chinese or going to Europe. Look at this data from the Nigerian Bureau of Statistics. You realize that our trading partners are India, they are China, they are Spain, they are Netherlands, they are France. It's just our trading partners, United States of America. You didn't see any African countries as trading partners. So that is a big challenge. So we need to look at how we can build it. And when you look at our trading partners, We look at these countries. We are not trading in terms of real sectors, in terms of agricultural products, especially for China and maybe India. All our other trading with those countries has to do with oil and gas, liquefied natural gas, so on. And then you look at it, and then they are the ones that import it more into our country. Also, we export it to their country, then they import the refined product back to us. So it's going beyond the trade agreement, because with the trade agreement, what do you bring to the table? It's what you have that you bring to the table. It's what they have that will bring to the table. And so we need to build infrastructure, like I'm saying. Competitive advantage is the way to go. They should not be jack of all trade, master of none. If we want to be in agriculture, let's think of what land, what area do we have that competitive advantage when it comes to agriculture. They have been proving that cassava is the best in the world. Can we begin to use that as a competitive advantage to begin to grow our product? So those are the ways it works. No country will just come up one day and just say, I want to be the giant in everything. You need to look at your strength. So Nigerians should look at our strength before we begin to go into bilateral agreement. You look at all those people that are trading partners. If you look at the United States, it's just used cars that made them our trading partner, because most of the used cars in Nigeria are imported from there. So when those industries cannot just come up here, Ford cannot just come, Toyota cannot just come. They tried to do that before, but our infrastructure, especially power, is deficiency. So it's not all about the trade agreement. The trade agreement could be there, but majorly, if you have a trade agreement and you don't have a product, What good is the trade agreement? Right. A trade agreement is better when you know you have your own product, you have something that they are in need of, and they also know that you have something that they cannot be bulldozing you and putting you on the red list, because you two also can't put them on the red list. Right. Remember the trade war between America and China. And remember, anytime China devalued their currency, America panic, because if they can, Chinese good goes cheaper. So it has to be, you have to come up with a strategy.
All right, Mukhtar, I'm afraid that that's as much as we can take. We are completely out of time for this particular discussion. Mukhtar Mohammed is an economic analyst, and we've been looking at the nation's balance of payment, balance of trade, and deficit. Indeed, Nigeria needs to up its game when it comes to, you know, being import dependent and all of that. That's the size of the show for today. I am Justin Akadoni.
And I am Mercy Boko. If you missed out on any part of the conversation, that's all right, to follow us on Facebook and Instagram. It's at Plus TV Africa, and on YouTube at Plus TV Africa Lifestyle. Do have a great morning.